So today we're going to finish up explaining light and some of its different properties. So today we're going to look at some of the different regions of the electromagnetic spectrum and explain in a little bit of detail what kind of processes that those regions generally cause in molecules and atoms and nuclei and everything. So we're going to organize these things, you know, and just looking in terms of the wavelength and the frequency. So right here, here's going to be my wavelength, here's going to be my frequency, and this is going to be the energy of the light. Okay, so wavelength, frequency, and energy. And we're just going to be arranging this here from long wavelengths and low frequencies and also low energies. And then these are going to go towards the short and short wavelengths, high frequencies, and high energies. So the first one here is going to be radio. So you've all heard of radio waves. Of course, that's what, you know, transmits information for your TV, your radio stations, obviously. Basically, these are very long wavelengths, have very low frequencies, and that's why a lot of times on the radio stations you may hear referred to as, you know, kilohertz and megahertz. That's basically those very, very low frequencies, and the energies of these are going to be very low as well. So radio waves, processes that they actually cause in, well, either electrons or protons are called spin flips. When you get to the quantum mechanics chapter, we'll be talking about the quantum mechanical property called spin, and the radio waves can cause the spin to flip in an electron or, you know, a nucleus such as a proton. So really, when we're talking about spin, basically, you know, we're going to be, you know, going like basically going from spin up to spin down. So if you just think about like a rotating ball going around like this, so the ball's spinning like this. Well, if you flip the spin, it's just going to be basically going the opposite direction now. So instead of going this way, it's now going to be going the other way. Now, where this is actually very important is if you've ever had an MRI. Okay, so that's magnetic resonance imaging. And what they do there is they put, you know, your body in a large magnetic field and then subject it to radio pulses. And those radio pulses flip the spin of the protons in your water molecules. And then what they do is monitor the radio waves actually coming off of your body. And based upon the intensity, they're able to figure out how much water is in the specific region. And from there, they can infer the density. And from the densities, they can infer what your tissues are actually made of. So if you have something which is a lot of water, it's going to look much different than something that has a lot of fat or something that is bone. And from there, you can actually get a pretty good idea what the makeup of the body actually is. So that's what radio waves do. They flip the spin in electrons and nuclei. Now, usually we see this with nuclei, but you can also do it with electrons as well. That's, you know, another technique that's commonly used. All right, next up are microwaves. So this is going to be molecular rotations. So basically what this is doing here is we're having our little molecule, and this of course is a water molecule, and if we're subjecting this to microwaves, this thing is going to start spinning around, okay? So this is basically your rotation. And essentially this is how a microwave oven works. All right, so you have your water molecules in your food, the microwaves come in, they start spinning the water molecules around a lot, and then what happens is these molecules go here and they bump into something else, and now this rotational energy has been transferred into translational energy. Now these things are moving around really fast, and that winds up heating your food up. Okay, so that's what we do. We heat up the water molecules, they start spinning really, really fast here, and then that energy, you know, from the collisions bumps into these other molecules, then they heat up, and then your food winds up heating up there. So that's what happens with microwaves. Next up is infrared. So before, this was molecular rotations, this is molecular vibrations. So what happens here is, here's a carbon dioxide molecule showing the three allowed vibrations. The black is the carbon atom in the middle, and the two reds are the oxygen atoms on the outside. Carbon dioxide is a linear molecule, but when perturbed, the bonds start flexing. You can think of the bonds as little springs, and the molecule has a certain resonant frequencies which it vibrates at. Also, because of quantum mechanics, the vibrations don't occur at random frequencies, they can only occur at discrete values. There are three fundamental vibrational modes for CO2. The symmetric stretch occurs at 1354.6 inverse centimeters. The inverse centimeter is a unit of frequency, which is commonly used in IR spectroscopy as equal to 30 gigahertz. The reason we use the frequency instead of the wavelength is because the frequency is directly proportional to the energy, and the energy levels are fairly evenly spaced, and they are also additive, which wavelength is not. So don't worry about the specifics, we won't be using that in this class very often. The carbon is stationary in the symmetric mode, while the middle oxygens are moving in opposite directions. Next is the bending mode, which is at 672.6 inverse centimeters. And you can see the carbon is going up and the two oxygens are going down. And on the bottom at 2396.3 inverse centimeters, we have an asymmetric stretch, which has the oxygens going in the same direction as the carbon, moving in the opposite direction. The A in asymmetric means not. So as you can see, the asymmetric stretch is not symmetric. You might think of the other ways a molecule could bend, but it would just be a linear combination of these three fundamental modes. The bending and asymmetric stretch are infrared active modes and what contribute to CO2's heat trapping potential and why it is such a potent greenhouse gas. Because of the symmetry in the symmetric mode, the CO2 doesn't absorb infrared at that frequency for quantum mechanics reasons. Here is the water molecule. The red again is the oxygen and the two whites are the hydrogen. Unlike CO2, water is normally bent. It also has a symmetric stretch at 3835 inverse centimeters and bending at 1648 inverse centimeters and an asymmetric stretch at 3939 inverse centimeters. All these modes are infrared active and do contribute to trapping heat and global warming. Now the reason why CO2 contributes more to global warming than water is twofold. First, water is condensable in the atmosphere unlike carbon dioxide, so water's concentration varies spatially and is controlled by the temperature, while CO2 is uniform and independent of the temperature. So as CO2 increases, the temperature increases, which causes more water to evaporate, which increases the amount of heat trapped. It is a positive feedback loop. Also, water in certain locations has very high abundance, so its IR trapping capability is pretty much maximized. More water vapor would make a very small difference. However, for carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases like methane, the concentration is much lower, so small changes in the concentration lead to large changes in the absorbance and large changes in the heat trapping capability. If you were to go and analyze the math, you would find out that the relationships are actually logarithmic. And if you were to look back at the vibrational frequencies of CO2 and water, they occur at different frequencies, so they absorb different parts of the IR spectrum. All right, next up is visible. And this is going to be for valence electron transitions. So we're talking about the valence electrons. These are the electrons on the outside of the atom. Essentially, if we think of the atom as a little solar system, the valence electrons would be our Neptunes and Plutos out there. So they would be the electrons very, very far away from the nucleus. And these are the ones responsible for bonding of atoms to make molecules. And essentially, those transitions going to be visible light transitions there. One other little thing here, if we're looking at visible light, this ranges from the low end at 700 nanometers, which is going to be your red light, to about 400 nanometers, which is going to be your blue or your violet. And you probably all remember from grade school, you know, your Roy G. Biv. Well, here your red is, of course, going to be your low energy light. The blue is going to be your higher energy light. From there. And of course, this is why this is also called infrared, because it's going to be, you know, before the red. So right here, there's your red, that's your low energy, and just below the red is going to be your infrared energy right there. The next one up is going to be ultraviolet. All right, now ultraviolet, of course, blue, that's, you know, the edge of the, you know, after blue comes violet, purpley color. So right after that, you know, ultra purple, you know, is ultraviolet color here, so that's what we call it. This. And what does it do? Essentially, it's the same thing as the visible. It's still the valence electrons. And the only difference here between visible and ultraviolet is visible we obviously can see, ultraviolet we can't see. So this is why these two regions are actually split up like that. All right, then after that, we're going to have our x-rays. All right, and many of you have probably had x-rays done at some point. And these are from the core electrons. So when we're talking about x-rays, and when they're normally produced, you go to the hospital, you get an x-ray taken. What they do is they have a piece of metal here. So here would be basically your little piece of metal. And generally this is going to be a piece of copper metal. It's generally used to make copper. Oops. And you're generally going to be using a copper to do this. And what they have here is basically a beam of electrons which come in. So these beam of electrons come in, and what happens is that these electrons knock out the inner core electrons of the copper. And then the outer electrons fall in, and when they do that, they release x-rays. So these electrons hit, and then x-rays come off. Because these are inner core electron transitions, they have a very narrow wavelength range that actually comes out of here. And just to explain this a little bit more detail, so essentially here would be my little nucleus, right? And then around there is going to be my little shells of electrons. When we get to the, you know, how the atom is actually put together, you know, it's almost a little bit like a an onion in some regards. So here I'm basically going to have, you know, my little electron there. And what happens is, so I have a high energy electron come in. This goes and then knocks that electron out. So the electron is going to come away there. And now what's going to happen is I have this empty spot down here. And the electron has a way to actually fall in. So what happens is one of these outer electrons here, up here, now falls in to take that place of the electron that was just knocked out. And when this happens, it's going to release the energy, and that energy is going to come off in the form of X-rays. Okay, so that's what happens. The electron beam comes in, knocks out one of these inner core electrons, so that's now free. And now that there's an empty space there, the electron from one of these valence shells, or an outer shell, falls down to fill up that empty space. And when it does so, that the energy difference between the outer and the inner core electrons is going to release these X-rays, which then come off. So that's what these X-rays are. These are these core electron transitions, and they have a much higher energy than before. If we just dealt with like these valence electron transitions up here, these are basically just between, you know, these upper levels over here. So that's a small difference, not much energy. Now over here we have a larger difference, a lot of energy being given off, and that's what's going to form these X-rays. All right, and then finally we're going to have here gamma rays, and you may also see it referred to as gamma rays like this. All right, and here this is of course the Greek letter gamma. Okay, so same thing, that's just, you know, written out versus the Greek letter. What this is over here, these are going to be nuclear transitions. So what happens here is that we have, you know, our nucleus made of neutrons and protons, and, you know, if there's a radioactive decay and you go from one isotope to another, there's going to be some energy left over. And you need to get rid of that excess energy, and that's going to be in the form of gamma rays, which come off. And gamma rays will not turn you into the Hulk. They'll probably just give you cancer. All right. Oh, and then just to finish up this little part over here, this, of course, is going to be short. This, of course, is going to be high frequency and high energy. So that's the basics. Basically, we start off at radio waves. These are your lowest energies, and you go microwave, infrared, visible, ultraviolet, X-rays, gamma rays. And that's, you know, the electromagnetic spectrum right there. So next up, we're going to describe basically three light sources, lasers, monochromatic light, and white light, and see what the difference is between those different sources. So we're going to start here first off with lasers. And hopefully you should know that a laser is an acronym here for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. All right, so this, of course, is where the LASER comes from. So this is why we call this, you know, a laser. All right, now what is a laser? What makes it so special? Well, first of all, it is monochromatic light, and it is coherent. All right, so what does this mean? First up, monochromatic. This just means, just break this word apart. Mono is one. Chromo, that's color. All right, so monochromatic just means that there's one color of light which comes off. And coherent here means that they're all with the same phase. So if we're talking about sine waves, you know, so here's my light coming off like so. And that means if I have my other photons, they're all going to be, you know, lockstep. You know, like one of those military parades when everyone, you know, the legs are all going up and down at the same time. All right, so this is what we mean by having nice and coherent light. That all my peaks match up, all my troughs, they all match up. So everything is nice and coherent in this regard. All right, now how does this actually happen? So what we have here are going to be two energy levels. Now, in actuality, it's a little bit more complicated than this, but we're just simplifying here to make life easy. So this is going to be my lower one, and this is going to be my higher one. And of course, the energy goes up, you know, in terms of, you know, the higher and the lower, right? So this is higher energy, that's the lower energy. So what happens here is I need to have a population inversion. All right, so normally, if you would just have your molecules by themselves, they would all want to be in the low energy state, because that's, remember we talked about energy, nature desires to have everything in the state of lowest potential energy, so that's where they all want to be. But instead what we do is, you know, we pump these electrons up, so they're now going to be in this upper energy state. This is why we call it, you know, this population inversion, because they're all going to be up here. Basically, there's going to be your little electrons up in this excited state up there. Now what happens is we have a photon coming in of the correct energy. So this is coming in. And then as it passes by, this electron once says, oh, I will release some of my energy. and then my energy photon, which comes off, will come and join you. So now this will go here, go to a lower energy state, and now I'm going to have the same photon going by, but now he's going to be joined by a friend, which comes from the laser, like so, okay? So what happens is this photon goes by, and when it's passing by, the electron drops to the lower energy state, releasing a photon of the same energy, because of course this energy difference is going to be equal to the same thing. That's why I drew them in the same color. So this comes down, and now I have two photons leaving with the same phase and everything going by. And now this is what's just happened. The light has been amplified, right? So instead of having one photon coming in, I now have two photons going out. So light amplification, and this is by the stimulated emission. So right here, this was stimulated emission because this didn't come down by itself. It came down because this other photon was passing by. So that's that stimulated emission. The photon passes by, it stimulates this to emit the photon. And then of radiation, of course, is the electromagnetic radiation. So that's exactly what's going on. Light has been amplified because when this photon passed by, it basically stimulated this electron in the upper state to fall down to the lower state and produce another photon. This just continues on and on and on and basically builds up a large amount of photons in there, and then that's basically where you get your coherent light over here that's all going in the nice same direction. All right, now of course, how do you actually build one of these things? Well, we have over here, on one side you'd have 100%, or you know, at least as close as you can get, reflective surface. And then inside of there, you'd basically have some your lasing medium inside there. So you need something to actually do it. So if you're doing a titanium sapphire laser, this would be, you know, a titanium sapphire crystal. If you were dealing with a helium neon laser, you'd have there some helium and neon gases floating around, or an argon laser, you'd have argon gas. So you just need some medium inside of there to actually cause to do all the lasing up here that you have your population inversion with. And then on the other side, we have here a partially reflective mirror, and this one might only be like 99% reflective, and then 1% transmission. So what happens here is that you go there, you pump this up. So there has to be some way of pumping this, either by electricity, a flash lamp, something, depends on the specifics of the laser. You pump this up, and then what happens is these photons start going back and forth and back and forth. They build up, they get more and more intense inside of there, and then eventually, because this is only 99% reflective, you have a little laser beam which actually comes out the other side. So here's going to be your laser. And then this comes out, and then you know, do whatever you need with it. So that's essentially the gist of what is actually going on inside of a laser there. So that was a laser. Now, what happens if we just have monochromatic light, but it's not coherent? So in this case, it would all be the same frequency, but your phases would not all be the same. So here would be my light, you know, going like so. But now I might have the thing which, you know, starts off over here. And then that one might, you know, just start going like this. You know, so the phases and everything don't all match up. You can see, you know, here this one doesn't match up with that. You know, my peaks and my troughs are all different, but they're all the same color. So they're all the same wavelength. So they're still monochromatic, but now we've lost the coherence. So this isn't all, these are not going to be in the same phase. So how does this actually happen? Well, if we look back here, it's going to be very similar to this diagram. So I'm still going to have my electron here in an upper state. Now, this doesn't necessarily have to be a population inversion. It can just be up there. Essentially what happens is that this will fall down to its lower energy state, and it will just emit a photon. So before, this was stimulated emission because it only happened when a photon actually passed by of the correct wavelength. Over here, this is what we call spontaneous emission. This just happens, you know, with actually no stimulation whatsoever. So because these basically just happen randomly, these photons over here are just going to occur randomly. So there's not going to be any phase correlation between these different photons. They just happen whenever they happen. All right. So this is going to create, you know, this monochromatic light, and that's all there is to it. Right. So this essentially just occurs randomly. There's no correlation between these different phases. Now this can occur, you know, if you're doing like an LED, a light emitting diode. There is, you know, no lasing capability. And essentially you could get the same thing here with like this laser thing if you basically just took off these reflecting mirrors and just watched the light that comes off, because, you know, there has to be something that starts it. So there's always going to be some spontaneous emissions that occur here. And the one big difference here between, you know, having the spontaneous emission and the stimulated emission is essentially the lifetime of these excited states. If you have a very short lifetime for the excited state up here, you're going to be dominated by just getting monochromatic light out because it's going to decay very fast. But if you're, this has a very long excited time in the upper state, then actually your stimulated emission will actually dominate, and you'll wind up having lasers with this. So actually, it's quite easy to figure out, you know, if you're going to have something which will lase or not. It's really just a matter of figuring out the correct materials. But the physics behind this is actually very well understood. Now, the other thing is, instead of getting monochromatic light, well, we could also get white light or polychromatic light. Right, and this is also not going to be coherent at all. Okay, so poly means many, and chromatic again means color, so essentially just means many colors. Now this can be just a mixture of different colors, maybe like red and green. It can also just be pure white light as well. So it's just a mixture of, instead of just having a nice well-defined transition, essentially what we have here is our two little states. But between these, there's actually many little states going on. So here's my low one, there's my high ones. And now what we can have here is electrons which come up from here. They release high energy photons coming out like that. We can also get lower ones which come off like this, which give us much longer ones like so. We can also have something in the middle here, which releases something, and then that's also going to be in the middle between there as well. So essentially, there's many different possibilities you're going to be transitioning between, and because of this, essentially, we have here, our short blue wavelengths coming off, our intermediate green wavelengths coming off, and then our longer red wavelengths coming off. And there's again no phase correlation because, well, they obviously have different phases because the coherent light's all different there. But essentially, we get many different colors which come off. Again, these are all going to be random. There's no lasing actually going on with those. Then just to summarize here. So transitions are going to be movements of the electron from one energy level, one energy level to another energy level. And over here, the change in the energy is going to be your final energy minus your initial energy. Okay, so wherever you're starting from, wherever you're ending up, that's going to be the change in energy that you're actually dealing with. Okay, now if your change in energy here is going to be greater than zero, this is what we're going to call an absorption. So in this case, we have an absorption that literally means energy is absorbed. On the other hand, if our energy change is negative, that's less than zero, this is going to be an emission. And in this case, energy is going to be emitted. So energy is going to be leaving the system in this case. So how does this actually work? So here, if I have two energy levels, so this is going to be E1, this is going to be E2, and if I have my little electron down here on the bottom, well, now I'm going to have a photon coming in, and it's going to impact this electron and promote it to an excited state. So in this case, my final is going to be E2 minus E1, so E2 minus E1 in this case. Now, since E2 is bigger than E1, this is going to be greater than zero. So what has happened here is an absorption. So this is going to be an absorption. And we're going to see, spectroscopically is basically a dark line because this is removed energy, okay, from the surroundings. Okay, so this dark line is because the light has come in and it's now removed energy from the surroundings, and we're going to see this as a dark line for the spectrum. So this is going to be an absorption type of spectrum there. Now, on the other hand, starting here, like so, and this is something we've already seen. Again, this is still going to be my E2 and E1. So in this case, we're now starting off at the excited state, and it is now falling down. This can either be, our spontaneous or stimulated emission, doesn't really matter. But when this actually happens, now a little photon is going to leave. So in this case, it's now going to be E1 minus E2. And the reason we've switched this around, remember, it's our final state minus the initial state. This was my initial state, here's my final state, so that's why it's E1 minus E2. And obviously, this is now going to be the opposite of that because E1 is less than that of E2. So this is going to be less than zero. This is going to be an emission because now, as you can obviously see, since this went down, energy had to leave. And this is going to appear as now a bright line because it has added energy to the surroundings. So energy has now been emitted. It's coming out, so that's going to appear as a bright line. Reverse, that would appear as a dark line. All right, and then one little final thing here, just an important note. Okay, so my delta energy, So the change in energy can be either positive or negative. But here, the wavelength and the frequency, these are going to both be, and I should put my and here. The wavelength and the frequency both are going to be greater than zero. The reason you cannot actually have negative wavelengths, negative frequencies. It literally does not make any sense. Okay, so the wavelength and the frequency are always going to be positive. The only reason that here the energy is going to be positive or negative is if we're having an absorption or an emission. But here, if we're talking about what is the wavelength of the light being absorbed or emitted, the wavelength is not going to depend upon whether, you know, it's going into the thing or out of the thing. The wavelength, frequency are both going to be always positive. So right here, that, you know, very important point, when you're doing your calculations, don't say that the wavelength is a negative or frequency is negative. It doesn't make any sense, okay? So these are both going to both be positive for that one. All right, so anyway, that's the end of part two for the light, and we'll just stop this here.